You've just learned Newton's laws of motion, and you're wondering, what can I do with these? Today's your lucky day. We're going to talk about applications of Newton's laws, including describing cars turning around tracks. And why are these tracks banked? We'll start by going over some general problem-solving techniques with Newton's laws, and then we'll look at some applications to friction, centripetal force, and maybe some drag force and terminal speed. First, solving problems. We want to identify the physical principles involved by listing the things we know, the givens, and the things we're trying to find, the quantities to be calculated, which will help us figure out how to get from the things we know to the things we want to find out. Then a sketch will frequently help us understand the situation better and figure out which system we want to investigate. We'll then draw a free body diagram of the system of interest, including the forces acting on the system. If we want to know a force that's acting on a body, that body might be a good choice for a free body diagram. After we have that free body diagram with forces acting on a body, we can apply Newton's second law to that body to solve for the things that we want to know. If necessary, we'll involve kinematic equations or relationships as needed to help us connect the things we know to the things we don't know. And as always, you want to check the solution to see whether it's reasonable. Let's try applying this to this problem with the tugboat. First step is reading the problem, figuring out the things we know and the things we don't know. So we have two tugboats pushing on a barge. We've got a force in the positive direction here. We're kind of already making a sketch. So this is a sketch of the situation. A second tugboat pushing upward with some force. And we know that the mass of the barge is a certain amount of mass. It looks like 5 times 10 to the 6th kilograms worth of mass for the barge. And the acceleration is observed to be a certain magnitude as well. There it's going at the direction shown, that 53.1 degree angle, with a magnitude of 7.5 times 10 to the minus 2nd meters per second. So kind of a slow acceleration, but it's a large barge. What do you expect? The next step is we're going to identify the body and draw a free body diagram. So the free body diagram, it makes most sense for me to use the barge itself. We'll draw our barge. Well, we'll label our free body diagram of the thing that we're doing. Here it will be the barge itself. And then we'll draw the barge. Look, it's a particle. All the mass is concentrated at the center of mass. We'll have some axes. And then we'll include the forces acting on the barge. So we have that F1. And F2, and then we have some unknown drag force that is resisting the motion. So if we're resisting the motion, it should be going opposite the direction of acceleration. Well, opposite the direction of motion, but since it starts from rest, that will be the direction of the actual velocity as well. So that'll be the drag force, and the direction will be that same line of action as the acceleration. Lovely. We now want to solve for that drag force. And how do we do that? We write Newton's second law. Sums of the forces are equal to mass times acceleration. And we break that down into x and y components and solve for the thing that we want to know. Let's give ourselves a little bit more space to do this. Here we have a free body diagram. We're going to use Newton's second law, the vector expression, sums of the forces are equal to mass times acceleration. We'll break that down into an x component version. Sums of the forces in the x direction are equal to mass times acceleration in the x. And a y component version. Sums of the forces in the y direction are equal to mass times acceleration in the y. Let's look at the x version first. And say, what's acting in the positive x direction here? Well, we have F1 acting in the positive x direction. F2 does not act in the x direction at all, it's only up and down. And then we have some component of FD. This is going in the negative x direction, so it will be a negative FD times the cosine of 53.1 degrees. We know that because we're projecting that FD onto the x-axis to get the x component of that drag force. And then this equals mass times acceleration in the x. So far, so good. What things do I know here? I ask, And I answer, well, I know F1. I don't know FD, but that's all right because I'm trying to find FD. I do know the mass. And AX, I don't know exactly, but I do know A. And I can do the same thing that I just did to find AX by saying that AX is going to equal whatever my actual acceleration A is times the cosine of that 53.1 degrees. And it's a positive. So I do know that. I just have to project it onto the axis. Now we can solve for the thing we want to know. We want to know FD, so we will try and isolate FD. We can think about this as subtracting F1 from both sides and dividing by a negative 1, so that we can try and get FD by itself, or you can think about adding FD to the other side, however you want to do it, so that we get FD times cosine of 53.1 degrees is equal to F1 minus MAX. And then we can divide both sides by the cosine of 53.1 degrees to get an expression for FD as F1 minus MAX over cosine of 53.1 degrees. We'll plug in the things we know. So this F1 is the 2.7 times 10 to the fifth newtons. Mass was whatever we said on the other slide, 5 times 10 to the 6th kilograms. And then times AX, which is A, it had a magnitude of 7.5 times 10 to the minus 2 meters per second squared, times the cosine of 53.1 degrees. So that's all on the top. And then on the bottom, we divide by the cosine of 53.1 degrees. We can now evaluate that, and we get a drag force of 7.5 times 10 to the fourth newtons. Can ask, does that make sense? It shouldn't be more than the forces that are being applied on it because it's only resisting the motion. So it would be strange if it could actually push it back the other way. And indeed, the 10 to the fourth is less than the 10 to the fifth. So it seems like it might make some sense. Now, it actually might be more if it's already moving at some significant velocity already. You could have a larger drag force and then it would be slowing down the barge. But going from a stop, you wouldn't expect that it would be accelerating opposite the direction you're trying to push it. Lovely. Well, what about the Y component? What do we do with that? Well, it turns out we didn't really need it here because we had more information than we needed. But if we didn't know the direction already, then you could have used the Y equation, the Newton second law equation in the Y direction, to have another linearly independent equation to solve for another unknown. So you could have actually done this without knowing the direction of the drag force, just by having two equations and solving for two unknowns, the magnitude and the direction. And if we were to do that, the Y equation would look something like this. When we look at this Y equation, we have going upward F2, F1 doesn't appear. Going downward, we have some component of FD, our drag force, and it will be the sine of this angle, 53.1. And that will equal mass times acceleration in the Y, which I can write as mass times acceleration times sine of 53.1 degrees. So from here, you could also use that to double check your work and say that my drag force should equal F2 minus MA sine 53.1 degrees over that sine of 53.1 degrees again. And so we should be able to plug things into there and double check that we get the same answer that we got using the X equation. Being able to double check your work is pretty valuable. It gives us a sanity check on top of the order magnitude thing and on top of the units thing, which I kind of didn't talk about, but we had newtons, kilogram meters per second squared, the newtons works out as well, to give yourself more confidence that you indeed did work the problem correctly. And as I was mentioning, if we had an unknown angle, then you could have taken this, which would have had an unknown FD and unknown theta, and this equation, which would have had an unknown FD and unknown theta, and combined them and solved two equations, two unknowns.